My name is Suzanne Sindi, and I'm at the University of California, Merced. So it's interesting to think about what it means to be good at mathematics, because I think probably in a way I was. If you think about mathematics as problem solving and trying to figure out puzzles and trying to figure out relationships, then yeah, I think I was always good. I was always drawn to those things. But those aren't always the things that we feel they are in school. So a very pivotal memory of mine was being in high school geometry, and we were doing geometric proofs. And the teacher kept using the word proof over and over and over again. And I didn't understand what they meant. And it wasn't until like a few hours of really working and thinking, and I was like, wait, you're just trying to get from point A to point B with this series of logical statements. And then it made sense. But so I think that puzzles and problem solving are inherent things that humans like to do. And whether or not somebody labels that mathematics, I think that's another story. So I don't know that there was ever a time that I said, I'm going to become a mathematician. I do know that I, as a kid, kind of wanted to do everything. And I think being an applied mathematician, I like still have a little bit of that element. So I grew up watching a lot of science fiction, particularly Star Trek. And I knew I wanted to be Spock. Like, I knew that. And then I read the book, Jurassic Park, when I was in middle school, right? And if you've looked at the actual book, there's like a picture of this fractal that develops, and Ian Malcolm, who is played by Jeff Goldblum in the movie, is a mathematician that studies chaos theory. And I think that was probably the first time that I said, oh, a mathematician is a thing you can do. But even then, right, I just kind of wanted to do everything. And when I was applying to colleges, I remember very distinctly that I heard, don't go in undeclared. So I said, well, I don't know if I want to do physics or computer science, so I'm just going to say math, because everybody's got to take math. And then I had phenomenal professors. And I think, like a lot of people who study mathematics in school, really amazing teachers make a huge difference in how you feel about the subject. And I was really lucky to have amazing college professors. And then I think I just really liked research. But that's also something you don't really know until you do it. So I don't know that I ever thought about being a mathematician. I just kind of did the thing at each next step that made sense. And somehow that's how I'm here. So I'm a mathematical biologist, and this means that I use the tools of mathematics to study problems that are related to biology. So the main focus of my research group is actually studying protein aggregation and prion diseases. But what being a mathematical biologist means is that you look at what you have, you look at the data, you look at the knowledge, and you develop mathematical tools. Some of them are computational, some of them are analytical, and you use those to probe an underlying biological question. And the tools that you use depend on the problem that you're studying. And because biology is changing, there's always new kinds of experiments, new kinds of data, and you have to be really creative about developing tools to work with new kinds of data. And it's, for me, a really exciting part of the job. Oh my goodness. So a lot of struggles. So I'm someone that has had depression, you know, my entire life. And it's something that I still deal with. And I think there's a lot about being an underrepresented person in a field that makes it really, really challenging. So I think that even though I did really well in school, you know, going to graduate school, you still sort of feel like you don't really belong there. And you always feel like there's some, you know, some book that everyone else read that you didn't read, and it tells you, you know, it tells you just what you're supposed to do. And then it manifests in so many ways. Like, probably you've heard the word imposter syndrome, right? And I remember when I heard that word, I was like, no, 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 other people have that. I'm actually the imposter. Like, I understand what this means, but that's not a thing that I have. Like, I'm actually the imposter. And, you know, these things come from so many different places, right? So it comes from being underrepresented. Both of my parents were immigrants. So there's like, you know, even though I grew up in the United States, there were still like a little bit of culturey things. And then I do think there's also people that just come from a culture where how you're supposed to act in mathematics is a little more known to them. Like maybe they had mathematicians that were parents, for example. And so it does make you feel a little bit out of place. So there was that. And then some of these challenges come from life. So I graduated with my PhD in 2006. And then in 2007, my father passed away and my husband got laid off. And 2007 was a very, very dark year. It was definitely a year that it was very hard to focus on work. It was just hard to think about anything. And I still look back and don't know quite how I got through that time. But the thing that you also never know is you never know when something really good or positive will happen. And so sort of just after probably the darkest part of my life and professional life, I met a biologist, Dr. Tricia Sirio. She's a yeast biologist, and we have continued to collaborate to this day through multiple graduate students and postdocs. And so I guess what I want to say to those of you out there is, even in your darkest days, there might be something sort of just around the corner that becomes a really wonderful part of your life. So one that goes all the way back to high school. So I still think that relative to where I was, the hardest math class I have ever had in my entire life was trig math analysis honors. And it was when I was a junior in high school. And the teacher, Miss Wendy Ubakubo, who I invited to my wedding, that's how big a figure she is. She ran this, now as I understand, she ran it like a college course, and she ran it to prepare people to take calculus and to be phenomenal at the AP. It was incredibly hard. She would give tests that you couldn't finish because she was like, yes, you got to read, you got to figure out where you can go. And it was, the math was tough, the course was super intense. And so doing well in that class is probably, relative to where I was, still one of the things that I'm the most proud at. And after her class, the AP exam was cake. It was absolute cake after getting through that. So I'm really proud of how hard I worked in that time. I really think it was about as hard as I worked on my PhD. Like, it was that hard at that level. So that was one. Then I think professionally, I met and worked with this yeast biologist, Tricia Sirio, and we had an incredibly productive collaboration, and we published a paper in Science. Science! Oh my God, I never thought I would do anything like that. And that happened when I was a postdoc, and it was just, I'm still so proud of it. There are still pieces of questions that were raised in that study that are motivating the work of my PhD students and my postdoc. So scientifically, that was phenomenal. And I was incredibly proud of that. And now as a professor, my biggest accomplishments easily are what my students are doing. Even though it's a bit cliche, I will start by saying I had incredibly supportive parents. So I think that that is something to be appreciated. And then professionally, I've had some incredible mentors. And I think that, you know, it's somehow like earlier in your career, right? The impact you really, it's a huge impact that you see later on. So one, my high school calculus teacher, Wendy Ubakubo, was incredibly supportive of me. And I think I really grew a lot through her, but I also have to say a very critical thing happened when I was in college. So I was doing undergraduate research with Professor Mario Martelli. I didn't feel really good at it. I felt confused a lot. I felt like I really wasn't helping. And I remember being like, well, I mean, he'd be doing this faster if I wasn't there. So I actually went to his office and I said, you know, I'm sorry. I think, you know, I think this isn't really working out, and I'm not going to continue to do that. And he did not let me quit. Like he was just like, no, you're going to keep doing it. And then I was like, well, okay then. but it's one of those things where I look back and yeah, it could have been real easy just to be like, oh, okay, well, take care. But you're like, no, you got to keep at it. And so in hindsight, I am confident that that interaction sent ripples through my whole life. And I think that not only was he a very good mentor, but he sort of saw maybe what was happening and was like, no, you're going to just keep doing this. That's all right. A really important thing that I want to leave everyone with is that mathematics doesn't have to be your life. Like, I think there's this idea somewhere that there's this ideal mathematician that only ever talks or thinks or breathes mathematics. And I think that that's not reasonable for any job. Whatever you do, have a part of your life that is you, that is fun. You should have recreation. You should have hobbies. Don't let yourself feel like your work has to be the only part of your identity that matters.